tweaked over the last little while, this ignite can bounce onto multiple targets in the team fight. And this slow that it applies, it's almost like when you hit a Viper. It's super obnoxious and it does so much damage. So this Ogre hero, on top of the fact, got 7 armor, all these nice spells, 3 HP regen per second. It's a really good support hero, and the Bloodlust is just cherry on top.
Pain Gaming have one of the most spectacular team fights I think any team probably could have drafted in for. You have RP into Black Hole, into Hoofstomp double-edged spill damage, to an empowered buff up Phantom Assassin who could potentially crit the entire team in one swing. And you got a Skywrath Mage who's also capable of sealing the Brewmaster to make sure there's no counter-initiation, but also dropping the Mystic Flare in the middle of the engagement too, and spamming out more and more abilities. Pain Gaming have the ultimate glory hole to be created. Like, that's what this is.
Oh gosh. Toby, you're right, man. When you're right, you're right.
Sorry, I should probably turn that around and say Hall of Glory. We'll call it Hall of Glory, all right? It's the Hall of Glory.
Oh gosh. Dude, Toby, you're too strong, man.
I gotta remember that I'm actually commentating to a bunch of people that probably watch more porn than anybody else in the world.
Well, if you put it like that, I mean, I don't know what to say. Oof, you're calling out a lot of nerds right now, Toby. I'm not sure how I feel about that. I feel offended.
Perverted people. Freaking perverted race. The Hall of Glory, all right? There you go. You can still snigger and giggle all you really want to. But we call it the Hall of Glory.
Oh, man.
But the combination is still good. All right, if we want to do it with the proper gaming, it's Wombo Combo is what it is. They've got a big Wombo Combo.
Yeah. Again, though, that kind of thing really forces on the execution of Pain Gaming. I can't support the Magnus pickup here when you have the Enigma as well as the Centaur. I think it's kind of overkill. And honestly, Magnus against most heroes in this patch, again, people thought it was going to be really strong and viable. It's not. It's overall a mismatch. The same issues transpire with the hero. He doesn't scale that well, and offlane heroes these days, they become these hero killers just like the Magnus, except they probably do what Magnus does, but better, like Batrider or Void. And they play it much safer as well. But Magnus is not a bad hero. It's a good hero. It's just in a weird place right now because he doesn't really fit the role that people put him on, which is this two position at mid. It just doesn't scale. It doesn't allow him to...
You can always do what like Koifa does and he takes it to the offlane.
Yeah, like offlane Magnus is fine. The only problem with offlane Magnus is, I mean, sometimes you walk up to the creep wave and you die.
Downside.
Yeah.
Well, if he had his old skewer pack, then maybe he would fit it a little bit better. Because that was the primary reason why he got taken off the offlane. Because they reduced the range.
That 1200 skewer was so dumb. That was like you sent it from one hill to the other, from one tower to the other, and like come on now. It's just
a level dumb. 1 ability.
Yeah.
It's fine. It's fine. All right. Anyway, lightning phase we go. So. Let's check it out. So we'll have TC, Brewmaster going up against the Magnus, played by King Red. Up towards our north lane, we have Ix Mike 88. This time he'll be the man over on the Batrider. Going up against Ned as the Skywrath Mage to support, try and zone him out. And 40R gives up the Naga Siren to pick up something just a little bit more aggressive, which is the Phantom Assassin. Now he'll need that aggression right now because Fluff and stuff, he's already rotating over. They're using Mike as bait because they've already got 4 napalm snags, and Ned, oh, it's nice knowing you. They're going to try and follow up here in a 40R. He doesn't have a blink strike, he has nothing. When the first blood goes to Ix Mike 88, Whitebeard was also coming up. He ended up actually doing absolutely nothing in that engagement. He did end up picking up his Fire Blast up at level 1, but he'll be that Ogre Magi. Into the jungle, we have Baja. He'll be the Enigma over there. And I think that actually wraps up our lanes, apart from the Centaur offlane, to be played by a new player, up against Oosh. Oosh. Who's Medusa. Is there actually a better way to pronounce his name? I actually, I think I asked him before, and I've actually forgotten what his answer was.
I think it's just Oosh. Like,
it's just
Usher.
Usher?
Yeah,
it's Usher. Like, is that meant to be like, Usha? I guess it.
Well, that would depend on his singing and dancing.
Did Usher really ever dance?
Oh, come on.
Does any R&B person ever really dance? Like, they just have baggy pants and just bounce on the stage.
Chris Brown, that guy's a good dancer.
That's true. That's very, very
true. Ask Rihanna.
Justin. I will. It not, wouldn't be the thing I'd ask Rihanna. 40 yards gonna die under the T1 tower. So we go 2-0 now on the board. The Centaur's also looking very, very unhealthy. If he only knew there was a regeneration rune on the bottom river, he'd be there in a heartbeat. Courier's delivering into perilous zones. Bringing boots and bottle all the way up for the Batrider. But they're really keeping a lot of pressure on this top lane. And the Enigma can't do anything. In fact, the Enigma's really being restricted too. He's trying to farm up as quickly as he can, but he's out of mana. And with 2.5 minutes in, he's cracked level 3. So it's not the fastest transition ever for an Enigma, especially when Fluff the Stuff keeps doing this.
Oh, this hurts so much. Yeah. He's destroying the Eidolons, and of course, if he killed the neutral, I mean, he would have split the EXP anyway, so Fluff would have been content regardless. And this Ogre Magi, Toby, you see this Orb of Venom item on this Ogre? It's made a wave in public matchmaking for almost a year now, but with the recent Ogre buffs, it's just coming back even harder.
Do you remember the first person?
This hero is actually so annoying, too.
Do you remember the first
Pardon
person?
Me?
The first person to ever pick up an Orb of Venom over on an Ogre Magi.
This is the first time you've seen it?
No. No, do you remember the first person who did it and when they did it?
Oh, who was it? I don't recall.
It was Puppy. It was Puppy almost 2 years ago.
Oh, was it now?
When he was just like sitting there going, man, it's a double slow.
Yeah.
Because I have Ignite and I have an Orb of Venom. Now, Flufferstuff's in, I'll say a little bit of trouble. Ned's in more trouble when Whitebeard rotates over. I might be wrong about that, because I remember we didn't really double check most of our stats we're using back in those days. Ned. Okay, he cuts through the tree line, but even stopping to do that cut causes you a large portion of problems. He can cut his shots up, but the ignites there, Fluffer stuff really slows down, and the blink in from 40R, they will get the stun off, and now 40R's got nowhere to go. They're out of mana for the Zicky Napalm, that's why he's trying to get the Firefly in front of him. The Ignite and Hellfire Blast coming off cooldown at the moment. Now, while there's no mouth for stun for the Enigma, he's just got Convergence and Midnight Pulse. So the other two heroes will back up, and maybe Flopperstuff getting a little overconfident on that top lane. Well, new player's doing the same thing on bottom lane, but his Observer Ward will scout the fact that Fluff's already rotating over.
Yep, that's the story for now at top lane. Of course, the lane is, I would still say, somewhat even. The Batrider is still getting the level in CS he's for, and of course his farm will grow exponentially as it gets more levels in Firefly. But yeah, regarding that Ogre build, it's actually so hard to deal with an Ogre that walks around the map with boots and just drops his level 1 stun and this maxed out Ignite. He catches up to any target, and if you're too far, like if you're too far low, for example, at the mid lane, you're where King RD is, for example, and you don't have a skewer, you might just end up dying to right clicks. That hero is interesting right now. I'm not too convinced on it being a core. I know some people have been, I don't know, I saw a Reddit very recently too about how you can spam Ignite. Cloud9 actually tried it last patch, maxing Ignite at mid lane as Ogre Magi. Mm-hmm. And you just find these problems where he just doesn't scale.
My Ignite experience kind of goes into just like a full dot team. I think I actually sent you a message about that, because I'm like, man, I need to go to my theory crafter, which is you. And I sent a message, basically going, all right, so how are you meant to beat a team that, okay, TC, he's going to split. King Red runs away. He needed that Storm Brewing to hit. He's moving in so deep for this, into the tree line, and then a TP out. That's not going to work, man. He threw the Earth Stun as well to make sure no more support can come quick enough. So a solo kill coming in there for TC, again proving his haters wrong. While up on top lane, he started the blast. He was waiting for someone to back up. Now, baited out twice. The Firefly comes in. There's no lasso. There's a blink away, but he's already got 3 sticky napalm stacks there. Make that 4 with the Ignite as well. And they're just diving in so deep. Whitebeard, you're throwing away your life, man. Enigma came in from the side. IX Mike ADA still got that flame burn with the flame break to Bajir as well as Nep. They dropped him a little bit lower with the creep wave that was chasing him down. New players looking for another battle into Ush.
I see that our previous talks has had no impact.
Yeah, it hasn't. Sorry, I just like his name more. It's Ush.
He's doing it again.
It's so much more epic. Yeah, but I want my theory crafter, just to throw this one out there for if we go back to our Ignite conversation while everyone should be chilling in their lanes. But you're actually able to go like a full stack lineup. So you use heroes like Jakiro, like Viper, like Venomancer, along with the Ogre Magi. and then you just need someone else with some nice, like, clearance or stack. And I kind of went with something like a Pugna, so you could force out the lanes. But you just end up going for this full stack lineup, and you throw it on them in a big area of effect, and you're like, well, okay. So I go from 100 to basically 30% of my life points just because of the tick damage. Not including any kind of burst damage you can work with that. Whoa! King Red! RP! He'll use it! His Mana for Skewer is coming up right now. The seal goes on TC. Well, TC's already got 1,000 life points. It's Skewer!
Oh, gosh!
He's gonna try a TP, TC! That was never gonna work! But, well... The Hall of Glory, no so gloriful!
Yeah, you know, if TC clapped there, and if he actually got the Skywrath in range, what would have happened is he would have slowed the attack speed of both Magnus and Skywrath, and he might have just gotten away instead of TPing. But, I mean, that was still a big mistake coming out of Pain RD. Not so much a mistake, but I guess miscoordination coming out of Pain, so I guess he shouldn't really have escaped in the first place. But the opportunity had risen, and it's unfortunate that he opted to go TP. But yeah, I mean, you know the lineup you mentioned, right? Like, Jakiro, Venomancer, those heroes will work with anything. And I understand the DOT concerns. And Ogre Magi can very well work, but in terms of an imbalanced strategy, I'm not sure, because it's like, it's relying on all these DOTs that
I just sort of balanced once. I just sort of balanced once.
It's a good strat, though.
It was just hilarious to watch. I saw a team, 18 minutes in, push into a tier 3 tab with that. They just dumped their load on the enemy. And the enemy was actually too close together. The liquid fire actually connected on three people. The Venomancer ulti hit everybody. The Gale connected on four at the end of it. And I'm just there going, this is not ending well. They tightened themselves up because it was the choke point on the stairwell. So they're trying to move down. So it was just one of those moments where it happens very rarely. Ix Mike 88 is going to Firefly up. And then instantly he's like, well, okay, Firefly Ned's standing right next to me. But it was in probably the last little hole those trees had, which was obscuring the vision from the Dire Ward. The attack cannot finish him off. 11 life points over from the Skywrath Mage will TP himself away to safety. Well, Fortiata decides to jump back into the flames. Magnus will pick himself up a haste rune, but he won't be coming top lane anytime soon. But a foul gank coming up from Nyx Assassins.
Yeah, so I think this was a really good demonstration of the Centaur focusing on the level 6 without dying. Of course, this is a Medusa Centaur lane, so you can't expect too many kills coming out, but the Stampede, it's so useful as a spell, and it's not so much like a Furion. It can guarantee safety more than it can provide aggression. Of course, if this was a Furion, then you would just use Wrath of Nature and just turn on the tri-lane or wherever the fighting happens, but overall, really nice hero and going to show its use once again. And of course, going back to the TC point at mid, when he got that solo kill on Magnus, I know it's somewhat of a forlorn point, but his Panda micro is probably one of the best in the scene, I would say. There's actually a few Panda players, like Jayo back in the day when he played Panda. His micro with Panda was really, really good. And you could tell with their Panda movements. Their Pandas never block each other. Whitebeard does fall at the top lane to the gank coming out of the Enigma, who is now level 7, and the Skywrath and the PA, so it was a rather simple kill.
Don't do that, man. The Skewer was your only escape mechanism. He was considering an RP. The Batrider will cover, but he'll keep his distance here. And the RP would have been a waste at the end of the day. He skewered the Brewmaster back under the tier 1 tower, which, funny enough, doesn't work. Especially when then Ix Mike 88 can capitalize and take out the creep wave with just a couple of sticky napalms and a flame break and firefly.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
And we've still got this this Medusa getting free farm. And the Centaur's trying to battle here, but the Mystic Snake is making it rather difficult to do so. He's taking away all the life points.
Yeah. I don't see the effectiveness of the phase boots. I have tried it before and I do realize it gives more damage and you walk around a little bit faster.
I think the best way to look at it, man, is why you pick up phase boots over in here like a Nature's Prophet. Because phase boots just allow you to be so much more aggressive in the lane, and you can zone out the hero with pure DPS. And right now you're doing a combination where you got Mystic Snake and you got your mana shield. So with that, it's just consistent chip damage into a hero who's got, sure, Tranquil Boost, but the regeneration, that's quite poor. Ned gets completely destroyed. The Skewer comes in, but he's nowhere near for an RP. And you got the Enigma coming in, they trigger the Centaur ulti. And Cyberlink Dagger, they can turn. Whitebeard, his Fire Blast is coming up cooldown right now, so he can set up whoever he wants to Flame Break. Pushes them back, there goes just over on the Centaur, no multicast for him. But they go one for one as the trade-off. Ix Mike 88, Blink Dagger comes back off cooldown. But you've still got now Medusa pushing into the T1 tower in the bottom lane, just the first points of damage into the lane. I just see it as more of a zone out kind of thing which you do from the Medusa, which is the face boots.
I don't know, I think Shreds just does it so much better. I think people who buy face boots with this hero honestly just became too comfortable with it. And just as you said with Furion, like, there are still people who buy face boots in Furion when it's not the right time to do so. And I think a good demonstration of that is just by the fact that Furions have no longer been getting face boots. And I think Adamo Bulldog really started the movement with the Blink Dagger, but yeah, with the No Talisman Blade Mail build too, you don't build face boots. It's not the kind of commitment you need in the lane because you get no talismans for it anyway. For the damage, so yeah. I do question it, and I think I'll end up just questioning it the whole time.
TC again, King Red being so aggressive with those skewers, but TC with the blink, I can just see it coming from a mile away. It's easier to evade than avoid.
This Skywrath better be careful.
Blink, clap. What rune? It was TC, and he actually took the bounty rune, and he wants to grab Ned's head. The RP is being committed! The Brewmaster's still got split, and Fluff's gonna come over. Just one stun means they can get the follow-up from Fluff and stuff. He's got the Edict damage ticking in as well, turns on the Pulse and over, and King Red, 20 life points, skewers away, but the attack from Lefrak was still gonna follow him over. Well, Baja was picked up and thrown out of here. The Midnight Pulse will go down, Whitebeard sealed up for the moment. The stuns are coming off cooldown for him. He throws over on the Enigma, just slowing him down. TC's considering a blink back into a clap. Considers and goes the whole hog, and he got the void. I mean, he got the black hole over on both the Batrider as well as TC, but where's your follow-up? Flame Break, TC needs some more space. Clap's coming off cooldown, bottling up. There's your clap. But a triple kill for 40R. And he wants another one. IX Mike 88, that Malifa stun causing him some problems. Blink Dagger in 1 second time on just TP out, and they can't see him. They have no stuns anyway. Not that can reach him.
I think they're gonna stick around for a bit, actually. Yeah, there it is. They finally discovered that he's gone, and holy crap, that Midnight Pulse covers half my screen. It is so big.
It's beautiful.
My goodness, that spell. Oh my gosh.
It's beautiful.
Oh, 5.25 damage per second, pure damage. Oh, that spell, oh my gosh. It's so strong.
It's a wonderful ability, isn't it? It's a wonderful,
yeah,
wonderful
so
ability.
Strong.
We got Batrider coming in for round three here in mid lane. You'll see 40R, but he won't be able to catch up to him, but that tree line completely gone on the side. There's little to no surprise apart from this Centaur with a Blink Dagger. The Courier is, however, bringing it out. It's going to come a little bit too late. The Firefly is on cooldown. They leave an Observer Ward behind. See, there's a ping coming up there from the Skywrath Mage saying, check in this little corner around here. But there's no ward there. It's directly in the lane. And Medusa also took the T1 tower in the bottom lane. That's the now Void Stone flying out. So pretty close to Lincoln Spear. We're still only 14 minutes into this game. The Courier flies over the top. Do they consider killing it? The Observer Ward to be dropped. And now the shield is up. And they're going to nuke it down. She had no mana for anything, not even Stone Gaze.
I want to observe how much EXP and gold. Yeah, that Medusa kill was 600 gold, 575, and 906 EXP. It's pretty good.
Not too shabby, man.
Yeah, pretty good for Pain right there. This kind of thing, like this
though.
PA, he actually started from the lane 0, 2, and 4. Started walking around the mains, and as you mentioned earlier, he got that triple kill in that fight. Ever since, he's picked up a drums, and he's made a complete comeback here. He's got the Aquila. 1,000 gold in his inventory. About to expand.
New player. You know what he wants to do? He wants to blink himself in, but now his Blink Dagger with that Ignite is staying on cooldown for him.
Whoa. Look at his skill build. Never seen this before.
A 3-4-1-1?
Yeah. He's got stats.
Oh, you're right. He does. They're coming in. Oh, man. That Lashrak gets destroyed. Whitebeard's still hiding in the trees. There was no support that came in to help him out because they're taking a T1 tower as a trade-off on the top. Whitebeard will now try and back up. I think he probably should have stayed in the tree line. He's got to turn and stun. Whoever's coming in, he can't do anything. He throws away his own life and gives a double kill over to the Centaur. And the T1 tower will go down the top lane, but you just lost both of your supports for that. And what did you really get in return? Medusa hits to the tier 2 tower in mid. Not the greatest trade-off at all.
Yeah, this Medusa's impact is just, it's not there at the moment. And even if she gets Lincoln Spear, she's still very capable of getting bursted. PA is really good at taking down Lincoln charges with the Stifling Dagger from long distance. So,
it looks like they have that going for them. Where we get to question the Lincoln Spear pickup on a Medusa?
I can't hate on it, honestly. It almost seems like an every game item. It really is that effective on that hero. Any spell you can block with that hero might just help you survive. And of course, the regen is most important. I've also tried getting Battle Fury just because it gives her so much damage, but really, this hero just needs to stay alive with a like Scotty, Lincoln, Manta, that kind of thing. She just does too much damage in the long run. Yeah, so it's ironic, but she doesn't have to build much damage. And honestly, I'm more curious about this PA build. I'm starting to wonder if this is viable. I don't think it is, but
going a full 1-1-2. Doesn't seem that bad. I realized too. I was like, clicking on the wrong here because I was like, hey, did you see the build? I'm like looking at center. I'm like, that's not stats.
Yeah, so she's basically got she's got 3 points of stats instead of like a max Phantom Strike or max Blur.
Well, is there any point to even max up Blur now? Because it doesn't help you with team fights. In fact, it does the complete opposite.
I don't know about that. I'm pretty sure that Blur helps you a ton in that team fights. The evasion difference between 20% to 50% is huge.
Whitebeard.
And Whitebeard is about to die.
Yeah, he's just getting... Yeah, he's trying to get a return sum, but then again, Brewmaster jumps in, gets a clap on two, instantly into the splits of the Centaur. There's no way out of this, and with the Pulse Nova coming up from Flubbersup, it's a lot of follow-up damage. He's got to hit this Enigma the second he hits the ground. Not going to happen. They had the stun there, and now 40R jumps on Flubbersup. The Mage Charge gives him some time, and another send-up. Baja, he tries to turn, but there's no man for a Black Hole, even with his 10-6 charge. Actually, now he did actually have him. Flubbersup gets a coup de grace hit onto him. But the battle, 40R will finally find him and bring him down. And TC's run out of its ultimate. The skewer's away to safety, but there's another Mystic Snake in 5 seconds time. That's a blink away to safety by the PA.
Yeah, I've concluded that this is definitely not viable. There's no way this is better than maxing Phantom Strike or maxing Blur. He actually couldn't cast more than one spell in a sequence because he didn't have enough levels on it, or he just wasn't that tanky, even though he had stats. It's 6 points of stats, it gives you 120 extra life points, and if you're rushing this PKB drum build with a strength dreads, you have more than enough HP to survive. I don't think this is that good. Interesting though. Thought we were about to have another burning animage situation here, you know? Woof, that was a close one.
Well, it's the reason why you're the theory crafter, man.
Yeah. It's nice to see this kind of stuff though. I mean, as much as I don't support it, I feel that it's good intuition to attempt it at least.
Well, for now, man, Pain Gaming, they keep farming up this PA to the point where she will pick up that BKB, at which point there's one ability that controls.
Oh man, yeah, and they're beelining inside the enemy jungle. It's
Whitebeard.
It's a train.
Sacrificial
lamb. Whitebeard walks right into the train.
He will get one stun off. Can throw your ignite, man. You're gonna die anyway.
Yeah.
He's gonna accept your fate at that point. Anything you've got which could potentially multicast, you throw it.
Mm-hmm. Seriously, that multicast to ignite, it looks like the most awkward thing because he's already done his throw animation and then just like this ball of white and red just pops out of him or something. But it's so annoying. The fact that it can catch like 2 to 3 heroes in the team fight and then more because of the AoE, ugh. Oh,
what do you think
so
about this from Fluff and stuff? It's really not normal for a Lashrike to do this these days, where Lightning is just such a powerful ability to not go a single point up in it and go 4 points Edict, but like the 4 points Edict I can understand because he's trying to force out Taos. He just managed to force the Glyph from Pain Gaming. But do you really need more than 1 point up in the Split Earth, considering, like, okay, you increase your radius, that's nice, but you don't increase the stun duration.
Actually, I gotta give it to AUI for this one. We've been theorycrafting something back in the past because he's a huge Leshrac fan, and of course the Leshrac player for Cloud9. Basically, 1, 2, and 4 is the most efficient and effective build because that lightning gives you that damage and you get all the good stuff from the spells and stuff. But Fluff is not that doesn't matter.
4-star from Mike trying to save him. Now he's actually killed himself. The RP being committed as well, giving a double kill over to this Phantom Assassin. That's a BKB.
Yeah. Everything's A-okay. The tower's about to go down. TC looks like he wants to engage. Oh,
he's coming in for the denial. There's a TP support coming in there. Alpha stun. That TP was coming in from an Ogre Magi. That was a yellow scroll.
He does not want to be there.
No. We've still got Medusa farming on bottom lane, however.
Mm-hmm. Like, going back to that point about the Leshrac, though, it's as effective it is as it is. This hero, if you land a good stun, you've done your job in the fights. Yeah. And a lot of times what happens with these 1 point and stun targets, they end up missing the stun and they end up investing this huge cast animation just standing there, which just makes you so vulnerable to some sort of initiation or jump. So I think this is the correct build, honestly. Even with despite the lightning buffs, lightning is not a spell that you should commit too many early levels into as a support. Unless you want to do a lightning stun build or like 2 points in edict only or something like that. think this build is fine.
Well, for now, we hit 9:16 on the board, 21 minutes in. I don't know about you, man, but these games, they seem a lot longer than what they really are.
They really are. I thought the first best of three was going to take like 2 hours total, yeah, including the wait time, downtime, pick, everything.
It actually felt like 4 hours to me, casting it.
Yeah.
It's just the first 50 to 20 minutes. We've gone to a point where there's always... there kind of always was something happening, but it's a lot more obvious when it happens these days. Alright, it just feels like you've run a marathon within the first 20 minutes.
I blame this Medusa pick, Toby.
Well, she's the one here that hasn't been involved in anything so far. The marathon has been run. Medusa caught a cap.
She's gonna camp the 22-minute rune here and stack up the Ancients, so she's gonna get a little bit extra farm off that, but... Overall, not the most farm Medusa. She's not under farmed by any means, but you usually want to be a little bit more ahead. You want to be in a spot where you can't have kill pressure applied to you unless 5 heroes commit their spells on you. And right now, this Medusa can very well die to much less than 5.
Yeah, once you have the mana style, it's going to be a lot more comfortable for her.
Yeah.
But also, once they start team fighting, because that's one thing which we have to take into consideration. Like, Pain Gaming, the meat fighting is 5. Where Sneaking Assassins have not. So for everything which Pain Gaming have, like, they've got their wonderful wombo combo, but Sneaking Nyx Assassins were purposely making sure that the Medusa was not involved in any of this. It might have actually punished them a little bit because just of how big that PA is getting. Like, you have a level 15 PA 22 minutes into the game, and the PA is getting bigger and bigger and bigger as time goes on. Yeah. But you at a point where Pain Gaming, if they just get one big combo, then your team goes down. And if that PA is strong enough, then you're going to kill them off. But if Singing Assassins get their perfect initiation off, with a very tanky Medusa there, with a Brewmaster causing a lot of chaos, it could end up being a lot worse for Pain Gaming if their combo is even slightly off the mark.
Yeah, which is, once again, somewhat dependent on the Magnus here. And partly with the reason why I didn't entirely support the pick. But I think one of the other things for Pain Gaming is they have good Roshan control. With PA, Roshan sniping becomes extremely easy, and as a matter of fact, they're going into it right now. So, Medusa lineups usually can't contest for obvious reasons. You have to have the enemy run into the Medusa, not Medusa running into the enemy team, unless the Medusa is vastly more farmed, in which this case, she's not. So, I don't think they're going to contest it. It looks like it's going to be the traditional tier 2 dire for Roshan trade. And,
this is not looking so easy though for them. 40R's taking a lot of damage for this. Finally get some Malifus off, and Sneaking Nyx Assassins are really scared for where they are. That ping came out from... Actually, that was a Skywrath mage, so yeah, they have no idea. Roshan will go down and be like, damn it, we could have been pushing this top T2 tower the entire time.
Yeah, they actually didn't get that. I'm surprised. Wow. That's very surprising. That hurts them a lot. Usually when you get that tier 2 at top, what happens is the team with the Aegis actually can't do anything for a long time because you can't push out the top wave because they were just there and you didn't see TPs, so they might just be camping you. And then that not only delays the Rosh timer, but also the enemy could just be farming the jungle and then come back to the mid lane. So usually that trade-off goes even, but this time the Roshan gets the huge advantage.
Looks like they're still going to give him the tier 2 tower though, because Pain Gaming didn't come back to defend it. They'll use their fortification. And there was one TP that came to the tier 3 tower, that's the Centaur coming up. And they just back it up. So, we actually get a multicast filing over on the Ignite. But this is a hand of Midas Ogre Magi. He's really wanting to get that level. Yeah, I know! 25 minutes in, he's trying to finish the damn job on it. But I've got a feeling he's just trying to rack up his points in multicast. Like, the levels are the only thing that are really mattering to him right now.
Oh, I can't agree with this. Ogre Magi with Yules this game would be fantastic. Or Gold Scepter. Or Four Staff. It's...
Or any other item.
Buying Midas here at 30 minutes into the game almost. I mean, I understand they expect this game to get dragged out because of the Medusa. But it really is not. This Medusa still can die to some sort of initiation very, very easily. And Pain Gaming's lineup is designed to win one big fight. And as much as Medusa wants to stop that one big fight, she's not big enough right now. So, going for a Midas here... Don't know, man. We'll see if it pays off. I'm doubtful, but I guess I can't say too much. I'll withhold my judgment.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
If he starts running around with 5 million multicast, then he'd be like, yeah, it'd be wonderful. It's like, but the Midas may not have got him actually that far.
Yeah.
It just means his ultimate has been leveled up a little bit, but the random generator's still got to kick in.
There it is. 2558 Midas, so 26 minutes. Ogre Magi, Midas.
Yeah, you can definitely add that one to the new one in the book.
Yep.
Very circumstantial. We've actually got to a build coming up from the Magnus, so he's starting up into his refresher orb. So, no surprise there whatsoever. The Basher build coming up from the Phantom Assassin, so looking for the straight lockdown control into the Abyssal Blade potential as well. Coming up from that PA. And with the buff up from the Empower damage, she's already hitting at roughly 230-240 damage a pop. Not to mention the cleave which she gets. And because she didn't have... Okay, goodbye top lane, let's track us down. TC can't help him out. But because she doesn't have to go the Battle Fury like we had with our PA in the previous game, because you got an Empower, so you've already got the cleave you're searching for, you've got to stay nearby the Magnus. You can go for items like this Basher.
Yeah. Abyssal Blade is so good on that hero. You know, interestingly enough, MKB is also really good on PA for obvious reasons, but I found that the new Butterfly is amazing on PA as well, because you use that Flutter ability, and she moves so fast in the teamfights and just chases down any targets even when your dagger is down.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, that new Butterfly in this patch is quite something, I have to say. Like, Gyrocopter, SF, these heroes that get Butterfly right after BKB as AGI carries, They got a huge buff from an early Butterfly. Does matter.
Just a small thing I want to flag right now. The fortification wasn't used when the tier 1 tower went down the mid. I know you're an appreciator of efficiency, but you should fortify, waste a little bit of time there of Pain Gaming, and then have it come through make off cooldown when the tower goes down.
Yeah, that would have been wise. Yeah, you can't forget that. Every single tier 1 refreshes the glyph cooldown, and that's one of the things that really kills the whole death ball push metagame from last patch. Although it's kind of still there in terms of heroes, just not the playstyle.
Yeah.
For one, you don't see Ross at the beginning.
Those frustrating things you have as a team is like, oh, I have to wait just that second longer before they can transition into their jungle. And that may have been, like, they'd probably bought them the time to clean up the jungle. I won't say it was exactly that, but you can clean up the entire jungle and then it respawns again completely. So technically, just by not triggering that, you could
Nice job.
They got King right into the tree line, the Brewmaster split's gone, the center ulti, and Skewer is able to save him.
Yeah. Again, that center ulti, proving its worth, and it's gonna come off cooldown faster than the Panda ulti as well, so if they want to follow up something, they have a 50-second window.
Firefly, they found King Red, but then again, Ned, you got the seal over on IX Mike 88 in time. So there was no Lansu, we got hit by the orb, that Mystic Flare well off target, and triple multicast. The RP will be used, but King Red, he's kind of in a weird position, skewers him back down again. The Skywrath Mage will fly it back, and we got actually a split fight for the R, who's battling up against Fluff and stuff. The Stone Gaze will go, and this will slow him down a little bit. Whitebeard looking for more multicast, cannot get them. Ignite turns around, there goes your triple multicast into that one. Baja also being slowing down. But they lose two heroes, and he can't get himself in range for the Hovstomp in time.
Oh!
He's just getting semi blocked up by the Magnus illusions that were there. But it's also the big slow from the Ignite.
The Aegis applied the regen from expiring, and both the Medusa illusions missed. So it didn't take it off. So PA just got back to full without any sustain items in her inventory. So that's really convenient for her. She's going to be able to apply some kill pressure to anybody that shows at the bottom lane here, while probably being able to farm the jungle. And as they say that, all of Pain are actually rotating down here. So they're going to push. Speaking of Pain though, no urns on their team. I think every team in this metagame should have an urn. I mean, it was the same thing last patch because of HP removal, but it's better this patch, so.
Seeing what's coming out from Nyx Assassins, they're just trying to... They're trying to do a split push main game.
Oh, do you see that bounce? Did you see Ogre Magi just now?
No, I was...
Look at the neutral creep on the Ogres. Radiant's they're taking damage from Ignite. The Ignite actually bounced off Dyer's the centaur that was right under the middle tree line there. Right below the ward, the set of four or five isolated trees. The creep was actually there, and it bounced all the way into that creep camp number 2, right above. Wow, that's incredible. Ignite multicast, boys.
That's actually what ended up happening too in the last fight. You had two heroes split themselves up. You had the Magnus run up that way, and you had the Enigma run up this way. And because of the triple multicast, he actually hit the Enigma twice.
It's unfortunate the damage.
And he targeted the hero that was here, but still connected up here. What is actually the limit on the range of the multicast?
I believe it's like... I don't know, for some reason I felt like I read 1150 somewhere. That's just a really weird number, but I think it might actually be around that. It's around 1000 for sure, I think.
The Ignite cast range is 450. Oh, we got an engagement up on top lane. Mystic Flare's already committed. The RP! Well, that looked like a little bit of overkill, but they got the track as well as the Batrider down the top lane. And more kills coming the way here at 40R. He's 10-2-7 on this PA. And by the looks of it, is actually skipping going the full Abyssal Blade.
Ooh,
and this might even be a Monkey King bar.
Which would be a good pickup, but again, skipping Abyssal against the Medusa with Lincolns. Not sure about that.
Oh, they found Whitebeard. Missed the stun! Triple multicast and the ignite. The Centaur's burning at the moment. Into the tree line, 90 life points. The ignite's still on him. Four staff up. 40 life points he drops down to. That's a support Ogre Mijai at level 11 that caused them problems. Can he please use that Midas?
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
Yep. Midas pick up.
Small little thing. But he doesn't have a camp. That's probably the reason why. Is that the creep wave's coming down. So he can take money from this. Helps him build into the Aghanim Sentry he's trying to get up and running. But yeah. He wants experience points. That's why he's going to move himself down and pick up this Wild Wing in a moment.
Mm-hmm. And he's not going to die. There it is. Pain Gaming is going to back up. He's going to the Wild Wings, as you said, and the Midas finally goes on cooldown. You know, it's a funny thing. A lot of people don't notice it either, but there's a lot of competitive gaming overall that's really, I would say, dependent on people and having their habits, which is why roles are such a thing for people to specialize in. Like, I was talking to Arteezy just about in between the games here, and he was telling me how he's practicing buying mech on some of his heroes, because a lot of times in competitive, you see this player who's normally really good, but they get put into this hero or a position that they normally don't play. And then, for example, Mechanism's a really good example, because these people that normally don't buy mech, and they don't use it, because they forget that they have the item, or they're just not used to clicking it for their supports and saving people.
Or even the exact timing of it would be difficult to, like, have an instinct.
Exactly, and now TC's getting initiated upon at mid.
Yeah, full stop there from the Batrider getting away, and then a triple multicast. There goes your stun, but the Flame Freeze gonna pull him back out of him with the damage from 40R! He rotates him! Barsha has triggered his BKB, there's Refresher Orb. She's coming out in the courier, it's not even there yet. So they have double RP if they want to push high ground, but look at top. The Medusa is almost reached the tier 3 tower here, while Pain still have a tier 2 to go through. And now the second they realize that no one's inside that base, he has to move up. Flopper stuff's coming up behind him, the Observe Orb will spot the rotation, so Hovstomp very much off target.
Oh man.
And then Floss, they're both doing a TP out now. This BT's over on the Medusa, so she's back to defend.
Yep. They're playing this well, despite the 2 kills at mid, and the Enigma not casting the BKB before his Black Hole, which would guarantee the Panda kill as well, and possibly change the outcome of what's happening right now. Their Nyx Assassin are adopting quite nicely, and again, this Medusa is just getting bigger and bigger. The only problem though is that this PA is full on snowball right now, and PA can very well fight up a Medusa, especially when you have Black Hole, Center Stomp, as well as Magnus Ultimate to fall back on. Mm-hmm. And yeah, this Magnus has a Refresher as well. And they're pretty much guaranteed the next Roshan too, considering the map control. Yeah,
they should be able to take it.
Really good spot for Pain Gaming right now.
Right now, King Red as well as TC. I don't know if they actually saw each other for a moment. They did back up. That Observer Ward, there's no way you can smoke here either. Nyx Assassin just being watched so closely. The Medusa is just sprinting herself down to the bottom lane. Hoping for some kind of like... I think she realized she needs to keep that push going. It's the only way. Also, they're trying to get that full butterfly into her. But at the same time, the Monkey King bar is being completed, so... Is this even worth... I don't want to say if it's worthwhile finishing, because it still is. But the major damage output, which is the PA, is capable of directly hitting you. That in itself is a problem.
It is. Most certainly is. Oh my gosh, just look at these crits. 1.2k? That's without the Empower, and this Empower that's going to transpire and exist through the BKB. Oh dear, man. Nyx Assassin better not find themselves bundling up. That's all I can say.
Well, the tier 2 tower is slowly being brought down by illusions. The Batrider trying to find an opening. They can see that Roshan is alive, but up on top, 40R, he keeps his flip push going. Attacks now into the tier 2 tower. And they're seeing just how much damage a very farmed up PA could do. That's without the Empower buff up. They got fortification available, but I don't think they want to use it for just their tier 2 tower. PA just takes it.
Wow, that's so surprised to me, because now this PA can actually TP back to the bottom lane, and they can go straight into Roshan.
Yep.
The enemy can't actually react adequately, because even with Firefly, you don't know if they're going on you, or you don't know if they're going into Roshan. And you know what? They're doing exactly that. This is one of those, like, objective-wise, like, strategic plays that I mean, I guess you can say the dire side has advantage of, yep. But that was really on the Radiant for not TPing anybody at the top lane and not using Glyph. That you can't give towers for free, even with the tower nerfs, because objective-wise,
they're coming over to contest this, but Roshan's already down.
Yeah.
The Aegis is in the hands of the PA, and now Whitebeard, they four-staff him up, but the center ulti will allow them to follow into this. And going high ground with an Aegis, the Immortal, and no Ogre Magi to battle up against, and all the creep waves are over the river in your favor. This is a perfect position for Pain Gaming.
Yeah, this is the time to push, right here, right now.
Yeah, their advantage is so high. Look at how quickly they can just mop up the wave. The only thing they have to wait for is the creep wave to arrive. That's the only thing they have to be
waiting for. Oh, you know, King RD, he sees the Medusa right now. The biggest play for him would have been to wait and camp the Medusa at the top lane and RP him as he's TPing. That would have been the biggest play for King RD. Oh, I think he just missed it. He came to the mid lane to help his team.
They want to fight. They want to fight head to head, but they're waiting time. The fortification's still here, and they haven't breached high ground. And you've already got the Medusa, man. Relieving the
King
pressure
RD
on the top.
Oh, he missed out the perfect opportunity for the game-winning play. All you have to do is just RP this Medusa once. Just get away with a skewer. She actually can't do anything. You can skip the creep wave with Magnus, go behind the Medusa, and then just kill the creep further away. She has no TP for 50 seconds from the boots of travel, and she's gonna try to walk measly with her speed. No Scotty to slow you down. You have Blink, Four Staff, Refresher, everything you need to escape. Ah, he really should have gone for that play. He had the rune. He had a ward spotting out the Medusa very nicely with the creep wave. Oh, that's just a shame. That would have been the right play. Yikes.
Shed a tear, man. Shed a tear. Well, for now. I don't think Pain Gaming, they're still going to feel confident in themselves. They have an Aegis Immortal. They have a BKB Blink Daggering Enigma. They have a Blink Daggering 4-staffing Centaur, who's got his ulti off cooldown in 11 seconds. The only thing they don't have is mana on Skywrath. They actually can't use his Mystic Flare, he's still just concussive shots only.
And he did pick up Urn though, so he's getting that Sobe Mask effect, that 50% mana region.
Yeah, but it's still not far.
Very significant, Toby,
Sheldon,
please.
We'll add a freaking sarcasm sign to this broadcast.
Positivity, please, Toby.
Well, the top tier 3 tower's now gonna be reached as well. And these illusions have split shot on them too!
Yeah, this is, again, like... I really wish he did that. That would have just allowed his team to push uphill. It's unfortunate. They're gonna end up delaying this game, and who knows? The Aegis might just expire on them again.
Everybody gets a bloodlust! You get a bloodlust! Everyone gets a bloodlust! He just multicasted and got three heroes all at once. So they're running out very, very quickly.
Honestly, in terms of Ogre buffs, I don't think he really needs any right now because he's in a really good place.
They found one. They found the Enigma.
Oh, nice pick. Nice
and
pick.
There's no follow-up from this. And the Enigma, well, he's got buyback off cooldown, but they just want the tier 2 tower and back. That's going to be the goal right now. And you're able to do that. Medusa with split shot mops up this creep wave so quickly, and with already another 2.8k gold on Medusa. And this tier 2 tower is already so low on life anyway. What does she go into next? Is it meant to be a heart, or is it just meant to be the Scotty?
Should be Scotty. Yeah, the slow effect is very important here.
Does the slow effect actually... Because I know with split shot, the animation goes in all the arrows, but do you actually get the slow from the split shot?
No, only
from coming in! The stun, no multicast, but they'll try and slow him down. There's your Mystic Flare picking up Whitebeard, but the pulse over from Blood was man! Hero to zero for Fluff and Stuff, 40R! Cast him in two with a Bread Knife!
Oh gosh. Send me armor, send me damage block, please. This PA. That was nasty. Simply put, that was dirty. Oof, you shouldn't be able to do that kind of thing inside a game.
Medusa's going in Monkey King Bar.
Oh man,
it's an MKB, and at the farm rate that she's going, because the creep wave, like, she's still pushing with the illusions on the top. If she farms up this wave here on the side, she can go and pick up the Demon Edge right now. Actually, she killed off all the conversions on the top lane. They were fresh conversions. And Batrider is right behind him. The BKB will trigger, and IX Mike will just lasso him. Drag him back. The Broodlings are actually doing a hell of a lot of damage. But now there's no Broodmaster rolling. Are they actually giving this kill over? Yeah, they are. They give the kill to the Medusa, who only gets one of the javelins. She can't just instantly TP back here. All she's got is one javelin, but needs a defense. The Mystic Snake will fly out. The Courier's going to fly back the rest of the Monkey King Bar. But it looks like Pain don't want to fight this at all yet. They're gonna back themselves up. But this Medusa only has one item slot left and has kind of got to be a Rapier or a Scardy. It's the only options right now for the Medusa.
Yeah. Actually, Rapier is a decent option. I don't know if she wants to do that though.
Medusa! What are you doing? Four star fire missing Claire. They'll save her into the clap follower. And now RP is only on Bluff and stuff. Multicast damage is already flying out. They brought down the Magna so quickly and they got the PA. The Aegis Immortal will be triggered. There's no Lasso available. And they wait for him to come up. The BKB will go, but that damage output into her is just so high. The Sticky Napalm is trying to stack the Flame Break. Not the perfect time. There's a long duration BKB with a force off up. RP, that's number two being used right now. Holding him in position, but they can turn to King Red. He'll actually skewer the Medusa away and away from the rest of them, but the damage output's enough. The Magnus will go down actually from the Ignite damage that was there. And Pain Gaming are being forced back. This Medusa has worked overtime. They actually managed to pick themselves up 7,000 worth of experience.
Yeah,
in that one engagement.
Know what? I think IX Mike might have been able to end the game if he, instead of changing the target focus to Skywrath, if he just kept going on the PA, he would have gotten the kill with the Flame Break and the Shadow Blade.
PA still has buyback.
Yeah, she does, but it would have forced the buyback and Medusa would have gone so far.
They got the Centaur. Drag it back. Where's your multicast? One and two. That's on the stun. Now the Abyssal Blade being used. The Black Hole trying to hold Medusa there. The shield is gone. Medusa is down for 95 seconds. YP, the follow-up zone being here, but the Brewmaster Split's also been used. Pulsar from Flumbers up trying to bring down 40R, and he's actually doing the job. They've got him down. The buyback is still available, remember this. But the Brewmaster searching for the kill. They forced half up. You've already got the Medusa who just bought back and came back in the engagement. The Mystic Flare, Mystic Snake being thrown out.
This PA is not playing back.
Just keeping this Blink Dagger on cooldown, and the Enigma's gone. 70 seconds on the sidelines.
Wow, I can't believe he didn't buy back and just TP to one of the outer towers. There were two guaranteed kills with the low HP Babadder on with no mana, as well as the other. Oh my gosh.
Oh, problems.
Wow. this is the weird thing, is that this engagement, if this PA doesn't buy back, not only do they lose the tower, but there's a chance that NYX goes for the upper tower as well. And if I was, you know, if I was in the position of NYX, I would say to myself, okay, there are actually four heroes down. Magnus can come back, but he doesn't have Refresher, and we know that. And of course, Centaur coming back might cause a problem, but PA and Enigma, we want them to force, like, we want to be forced into buybacks. And that lack of a buyback there, for better or for worse, I'm not too sure, but I feel like if NYX played this properly, that PA would end up buying back anyway. Then again, the DC just happened. I don't know what's been happening with their computers, so.
I just assume internet drops. They might be playing in LAN cafe.
Probably, right? I mean, the way they dropped it seemed like a power outage or something.
Yeah. I'm gonna double check in our conference. To see what's going wrong. But what a nice time to drop. It's just after you basically get, team wiped. And you sit there. The amount of experience and gold they earned off that was ridiculous. The difference is now only by 4,000 in the experience after it was almost 14,000 advantage.
Yeah.
So just
that bottom lane, that was a throw. That's a pretty big throw. Like, mm-hmm. Magnus got greedy instead of committing the RP right away. And even with the RP, that Medusa would have gotten forced back anyway. Well, so I guess
he also had to buy back to actually do that second RP. Like,
yeah,
the first
right.
RP was on a solo fluff and stuff. He never found a proper target, so Fluff gets stunned and like, well, this is going to do us good. And then nothing more.
Yeah, well, Fluff is pretty happy that he was the only target there, for sure. And the Magnus came back, second RP dropped, he got one kill, but he still ended up paying for it with his life. So, I mean, in terms of items, he doesn't have too much to go at this point, aside from a BKB, but for what it's worth, he really wants that BKB, and I think last fight was a pretty good demonstration of that. But the other thing is, I think he needs some more patience, and he wants a smoke, most importantly. For Magnus to work properly, especially when it comes to high ground defenses, overall, like, not many people buy smokes enough, and I think S4 is like the only one that really, really does it well. You want to always be out of vision, because you have to deceive the enemy that you're not there, whether it's obvious or not. Because without being able to see where you are exactly, simply put, they'll have to play differently.
I'm hoping what they're saying is just a joke. But all the players from Pain will now be coming in, so they're good to go again. And
okay. Oh, yeah. Looks like the call has given.
Yep. Let's go. So Batrider. This guy's even tried build into a refresher or light like 88, and he gets a regeneration room bolted up. He couldn't have got any luckier for him.
Yeah, how convenient, really.
Yeah, his Lasso's coming off cooldown, he's gonna be full life, full mana, and they come high ground. That creep wave doesn't survive long up against Medusa, especially them three Medusas. Attacking into the tier 3 tower, the fortification set, the blink lasso, whoops, Mike, he walks straight past it. I don't know if he's trying to, if he just thought he, did he get sealed or? Now I see, it only got one, they forced off him, no! King Red, they're trying to bait him in. Then again, for some reason, Stonegaze. Then again, Baja blinked himself into Stonegaze. Little bit of misplays on their combination there, but the RP is down. There's no refresher on the bubble. They're gonna jump in and try and fight this one. There's no split of bubble for TC. The clap will be there. Mystic Flare. TC gets burned inside the fire. Medusa will go down. Then the double edge. Ice Mike takes the fall. We go from one throw to the other. And they're searching for another one. Flopper stuff, slowing down by Concussion Shop. Now Malifus, then the Siphoning Dagger, even getting a coup de grace crack on it. The Gem of Truth will be lost. Roshan's still down for another potentially 1 minute or more. But Pain Gaming just won a huge fight for them.
The Medusa also down for more than a minute. She doesn't have buyback.
It's true. They gotta push.
Oh man, this is the time.
They get 9,000 experience from that, and overall probably about 15. That's actually more than that. That's 3,500 worth of gold.
I mean, honestly, this Medusa Toby is 40 to 50% of the net worth on the side of Sneaky Nyx assassins. They can't hold without the Medusa.
No, they can't. They have fortification though. A Brewmaster split might be able to do some work here. Just drunkening hazing her from the PA as much evasion as possible. Now King Red's come in with his own BTs. Refresher Orb is up, but it's not the 20 seconds until the RP is available. The mid melee ranks did, however, go down in favor of Sneak Nyx Assassins. So they could try and defend this with just four heroes, but it's a tall order. A really, really tall order. They've lost a lot of their damage output. You're going to need multicast galore coming up from these heroes.
I don't think multicast galore works through BKB at this point.
No, it doesn't, but then again, DBS gets to go to BKB off the RP! Double four-man RP, watch him cleave, watch him die! GG! Pain Gaming take game number two. And are we going to be looking at the second upset loss of the night for the D2CL? The Brazilians want it to be so.
Wow. What can I say? That is super brutal for them to have that game ended. From a pause that disconnected all five members of a team, within a 100-second time span, they just come back and take